Hello, boys and girls, and welcome to another fire lesson. I hope you guys are doing good. I understand that some of you are back in school now, and I know you're excited about that, and I hope that you're able to make new friends and also meet up with your old friends that you had before. That probably some of you probably haven't seen some of them since last year. So that's great. I know that's exciting for you. Well, this is a new lesson, and the title of our lesson today is New Life in Christ. And we also have a subtitle, which is Knowing Jesus and Making Him Known. Okay? And our memory verse for today is Luke 14, verses 26 and 27. All right. Well, let's get started first of all in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so very much for your fantastic love for your children, Lord. We just thank you for this fire ministry. We thank you for Hope Christian Church. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the installation of our new pastor, Johnny Michelle Jackson. We just thank you, Father. We thank you for keeping her safe from all harm and danger. We thank you for leading her and guiding her, Father. And Lord, we just thank you for the Hope Christian Church ministry. And again, we thank you for this lesson for today. We pray for all of the children to have their ears wide open and eyes open and their hearts ready to accept your word. In the name of Jesus, thank you and amen. Well, what are we going to do today? We're going to learn more about God's word, okay? And what he wants you to know, okay? And again, our lesson title is New Life in Christ. But first, we just want to say, what is, you know, when we talk about new life, I guess we got to talk about old life also, right? New life, old life. So let's give you some examples of what I'm talking about. Let's say that, for you who are in the fifth grade, last year you were in the fourth grade. So if someone came to you and say, oh, you're in the fourth grade, and you're going to correct them and say, no, I'm not in the fourth grade. I'm in the fifth grade. I'm bigger now. I'm in the fifth grade. So you don't want to have nothing to do with the fourth grade anymore. And the same thing about our age. If you are 11 now, and someone said, oh, you're 9 years old. And you would say, what? I am 11, thank you very much. I'm 11 years old. So sometimes we go from one part of our life or one dimension of our life to another dimension. And so I just wanted to just go through that. Another old and new item we might have is sometimes when, you know, children may have some behavior problems at school, and next thing you know, the school principal or school, the teacher from the school or someone is calling your parents to let them know, hey, so-and-so is acting up in school. Wow. And, you know, when you get home, and then the parents give you a very, very strong talk about behavior and consequences. And so when those consequences are taking your cell phone or taking your games system away, hey, we have a very, very different attitude. We say, I don't want my cell phone taken away. I don't want my game system taken away. So I'm going to change my behavior. I don't want to do anything that's going to upset my parents. So I'm going to change my behavior to being obedient to the school officials and your school teachers. So we're talking about, again, the old and the new. The old is being disobedient and misbehaving. And then the new is being obedient and having your behavior be the way it should be, okay? And one more item I wanted to talk about is Sometimes people don't want to wear their seatbelts in their cars when they're going from place to place. And when that happens, well, sometimes an accident can happen. And if you're not wearing your seatbelt, when an accident takes place, the person can be thrown from the back of the car all the way to the front, and sometimes hitting the windshield. Well, that happens a lot. And that's why seatbelts are very important. So in an incident where a person is not wearing the seatbelt and an accident occurs, that person can be thrown all the way from the back of the car all the way to the front. And that can be a very, very traumatic experience. And I think that if that happens to a person, that person will change that particular behavior. And they will put their seatbelt on every time they get in the car, because they don't want to be thrown from the front or from the back of the car to the front of the car. And so that's something that we have to think about. And that's another example of a new and old way of thinking, or a new old way of living. Okay. Now let's talk about the old and new way of a new life in Christ. Okay. Now some people don't know Christ as their personal Savior. So if they don't know Christ as their personal Savior, then that means that they have to be told, or they have to learn about Christ and their person being their personal Savior. So the old life is when they don't know Christ, and the new life is when they do know Christ. And so we have that in many cases. That's why in our church, at the end of a service or during the service, the leadership in the church will call people up who want to be saved, who want to give their lives to Christ. And sometimes that happens that way. Sometimes it's during a sermon. Sometimes it could be at home. Sometimes it could be in the street. It could be anywhere. It could be anywhere where a person's life is transformed from not knowing Christ to knowing Christ. And when you learn about Christ, when you allow him to live in your life, that means that you have a new life in Christ, and that old life is no longer in existence. Okay. And so let's read our memory verse. Let's talk about that. The memory verse is Luke 14, verse 26 and 27, okay? And it reads, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own mother and father, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." This is what Jesus said. Okay, you cannot be my disciple if those things are not in place. Why? Well, first of all, God and Jesus is one, and God is God. He's controlled the whole earth. He's our Savior. He's our Lord. He's our everything, and so God put this world together. That means he's all power, okay? Now, your mother and your fathers and your brothers and your sisters and even yourself, you don't have that kind of power, and they don't have that kind of power. So God says, if you want to follow me, then you have to put me first. You have to put me first in your life. And that's very important. Putting God first. Because you put God first, he's going to put you first. And he's going to look out for your needs. And he's going to take care of you. And you will one day be in heaven with him. Okay? So that's why we put God first in our lives. And he says, everything else, you know, got to be after me. I'm first. First and foremost, okay? And so but we still have our prayers, right? So God, when you put God first, God will have your parents be good parents. Have your parents do the things they're supposed to do and be responsible to you, okay? So when you put God first, he makes sure that everything else in your life is going the way it's supposed to go. That's why it's important to put him first, okay? So I'm going to put it on pause for a minute and we come right back. Hello, fire. We're back. I'm back. Okay. Now, we talked about putting God first in our lives and changing our lives from one point, one dimension to another dimension. Let's look in the Bible. And in the Bible, there are several verses or passages where there were people in the Bible who also had a transformation. They went from the old to being new life, being a new life in Christ. Okay? So all of those people that I'm talking about is in the book of Acts. And what I want you to do, because we're not going to go through all of them because it would take too long. But what I would like for you to do is I'm going to give you, I hope you have a paper and a pencil to be able to write down the scriptures. So I've already given you the memory verse, which is Luke 14, verse 26 and 27. Now, I will give you the passages where we can find people whose life was transformed from the old to the new life of Christ, okay? Now, again, all of these verses, all of these passages are in the book of Acts. And I'm going to give you the chapters, okay? The first chapter where you'll find a transformation of one of life going from the old to the life of Christ is Acts 2. Acts chapter 2, chapter 8, chapter 9, chapter 10, chapter 16, chapter 17, chapter 18, and chapter 19. And these are the passages where you will be able to find where people actually went from not being in Christ to being new in Christ, okay? And in chapter 2, as a matter of fact, it talked about Peter presenting a message, giving a message to a group of people, a whole lot of people, as a matter of fact. And after that message was given, 3,000 people gave their lives to Christ. 3,000 people had their lives changed, okay? Because they decided they want to be a follower of Jesus Christ, okay? 3,000 people. That's amazing. But in those other chapters that I gave you, you will also find where lives were transformed from the old to the new, okay? Next thing I want to do is tell you about the some verses, some passages about a result of your life being transformed. When your life is transformed to a new life in Christ, whoo, that is some amazing things happen, okay? Let me just read some of the passages, some of the scriptures that talks about just a few of them, some of the things that will happen. Okay, when you become a child of God, first of all, in Romans 8:16, it says that when you give your life to Christ, you become a child of God. In Psalms 91:11, it says, you are kept in safety wherever you go. You are kept in safety wherever you go. Philippians 4:13 says, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Okay? That means that, wow, I got a test to, I have a test next week or tomorrow. I got to study. Okay? Now, once you go into that test tomorrow or the next week, Christ is with you. He's with you. Okay? He's with you. Okay? So I can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. The next one is Romans 8:17. You are an heir to God and a joint heir to Jesus. You hear that? You are an heir to God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. That's powerful. That's powerful. Okay? Another one is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. And it says, you are healed by Jesus' stripes. You are healed by his stripes. Okay? That means that if you get sick, then the Bible says that you can be healed. You can be healed by the stripes of Jesus Christ. Now, what are we talking about when we say stripes? The stripes the stripes happened to Jesus when he was whipped. When he was being crucified, before he was crucified, he was whipped. Very, very, it was terrible. He was whipped until he was could barely stand up. And when that whip went across his back, it puts marks on his back, and we call them stripes. So we say that by his stripes, you are healed. So if you get sick and you belong to Christ, God will heal you. Okay? And another verse is Romans 8:37. And it says, you are more than a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror. So that means that you are a winner. You are a winner. Okay? You're a winner. And God says that in his word. Okay? Now, the next one, and which is the last one of this series, it says, Matthew 5:14. It says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. That's what God thinks of you. You are the light of the world. Now, as you read these passages, and I want you to read them again. Read them at home. Read them in your spare time. You should know these things about you when you give your life to Christ. Okay? You should know these things. Okay? They have to be in your heart. They have to be in your heart. They have to be in your heart. And you have to meditate on them. About Romans 8:16. About you being a child of God. You have to see yourself. You have to think of yourself as a child of God. Okay? And each one of those passages that I read, you have to think of yourself as being what those passages says. Because it's through your faith and your belief that these things are manifest. Okay? By the way, I know that some of you have already given your life to Christ. But what I want to do is, for those of you who may not have given your life to Christ or may be new to the fire ministry, I would like to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus as your personal Savior. And what I want to do now is just have you to repeat after me. If you want to give your life to Christ, I want you to repeat after me, and you will become saved if that's what you want to do. And I'm hoping that's what you want to do, because hallelujah, being in the family of believers, being in the family of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that's awesome. That's awesome. Okay, this is what I want you to say. Just repeat after me. Dear Father, I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. because of his love for me. I believe that God raised him back from the dead. I ask that Jesus come and dwell in my heart so I can be saved. And if you said that, you're saved. Okay? And also, once you become saved and you know all the benefits that you have from being saved, don't you want all of your friends and all of the people that you know, your family, your brothers, your sisters, and your nephews, and everybody, don't you want them to have the same benefits that you have? Yes, you do. So you need to tell them. That's the second part of the title. And when it says, knowing Jesus and making him known. So you have to make him known to your peers. Make him known to your friends at school. Make him known to your sisters and brothers. And make him known to everybody that you know. Tell them about Jesus. Okay? Because Jesus is the Son of God. And Jesus created us. God created everyone. God created all of the heaven and the earth. So that's power. And don't you want your friends to be associated and know the power of God? Yes, you do. So you have to tell them about Jesus and tell them about how wonderful he is and tell them how much he loves you and your friends as well. Okay? All right. Well, that wraps up the lesson for today. I thank you for being there. And don't forget, let me give you my telephone number because I want you to send me a summary or send me something about the people in Acts. You know those passages I gave you in Acts? I want to know one or two. Just, you don't have to read all of it, but if you read all of it, that's great. Just read one or two and let me know about whose life was transformed from that old to the new, okay? From the old to the new. So when you send me that, I have something special for you, okay? Again, my name is Daniel Floyd, and my telephone number is 240-401-8722. 240-401-8722. And get your parents to help you with that and help you send me that information through a text. It's fine. And also let me have an opportunity to get with you so I can get your address so I can have your surprise sent to you. Okay? Well, God bless you, and we'll see you next time.